Maybe you took your man a mini cooking.
All right, well, good morning, and we are so glad that you're here to just worship this morning, and I'm excited to have our graduating seniors here with us today, and we're going to just recognize them. I thought that song was fitting, I Am Free, right? So now they're free from high school. So they did a great job. Let me just tell you a little bit about each one, and then they're going to share what their plans are for their future. And so let me first start with Audra L. Beard. She is the daughter of John and Leslie Beard. She was awarded a couple different honors, awards, and scholarships, one being the Presidential Scholarship, a full tuition. She's also part of many clubs and organizations. All right, she is actually playing here just a little bit, is that right? And singing. So, all right, so that's one of the areas where she is involved. Also one of the most influential people in her life, she said it was her mother. She has been my teacher through my many years of school. She has not only been a teacher to me, but also an amazing role model. So, Audra, tell us what you're going to do after now that you're about to graduate.
I plan to go to college and major in psychology and become a Christian counselor.
Awesome. All right. Next, we have Zachary James Clark, the son of Jim and Deborah Clark. And again, he is awarded many different awards and scholarships, one of those being the American Legion Military Excellence Award. He's also part of a couple different clubs and organizations, one being the Boy Scouts of America. And then asked if there's a favorite verse or reference or quote. He said Psalm 139, verses 9 through 10. It says, "If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me." So, Zach, tell us what you plan to do.
I am joining the Navy as a hospital corpsman.
Next, we have Obi Agbujo, and he is the son of Sydney and Christiana Agbujo. When asked who was the most influential person in his life, he said, "Parents, and also my sister and brother. They are always there for me and always encouraging me." One of his favorite references is Philippians 4:13. "I can do everything through him who gives me strength." Obi, tell us what you plan to do after graduation.
I'm going to go to college at Drake to learn about computer engineering.
Jonathan Andrew Grace, the son of Cameron and Anna Grace, also had many scholarships or awards, one of those being the Huntsville-Madison County Builders Foundation Scholarship. He was also part of the Grissom Band for 4 years and the Technical Theater of Grissom for 3 years. A favorite verse of his is Matthew 28:20. It says, "Teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." All right, John, tell us what you plan to do after high school.
I plan to go to Auburn University and study architecture.
Next, we have Madeline Parker Jory. She is the daughter of Edward and Jennifer Jory. Some of her scholarships will include the Spirit of Auburn Presidential Scholarship, Auburn Marching Band President's Scholarship. You guys guess where she might be going to school? Again, many different organizations or groups or clubs that she's a part of. One of those being a member of the Grissom High School Marching and Concert Band for four years total. 1 year as French horn section leader. 2 years as drum major. 1 year as coordinator for the Rocket City. That's another one. 1 year as a rocket coordinator for the Rocket City Math League, and her list goes on. And then when asked somebody that is influential in her life, my mom, because she has always been there for me, been supportive of me, and helped me to succeed. So, Madeline, tell us what you plan to do after high school.
I'll be attending Auburn University to double major in music education and chemistry.
Next, we have Peyton Charles Coolers. He is the son of Darren and Jenny Coolers. Some of his awards are scholarships, Spirit of Auburn Founders Scholarship for $32,000. He's also part of the National Honor Society at Grissom for 2 years. And a life verse for him is 2 Timothy 2:22. And actually one of his favorite quotes would be from Elliot Pulse. Did I say that right? All right. No one can tell you who you are becoming or what path you are going to follow. And he said, tell us what you're planning on going after high school.
I'm going to study chemical engineering at Auburn University.
She's more evil. All right, then we have Tiffany Nicole Miller, the daughter of Jeff and Debbie McClellan. She has been part of our youth ministry here at the church for several years, somebody that was influential in her life. She says her mom, she has helped her help me become a better person, and I'm so happy to have her in my life. She also quotes from Proverbs 31:25, and that passage says, she is clothed with strength and dignity, she laughs without fear of the future. And so Tiffany tells me you plan to do after high school.
I plan to go to Cal
and
get my basics
in the art degree and school. All right. And we have Shelby Blake Tacon, daughter of William and Michelle Bloodworth. She was awarded the Byron College of Golf Scholarship. She was varsity girls all county in 2016 with multiple top 10 finishes for this golf season. Again, she was part of the Madison County varsity golf team, FCA for 4 years, FCLA for 2 years, and she has a host of other organizations she's a part of. I will read this. She said the most influential person in her life, Terry and Dimitri Tacon, grandparents, have always played a big role in my life. Growing up watching their love for others and for their love for Christ has helped me see a bigger picture of who I want to be in life. I'm very lucky to have such a close relationship with them. They're not only my grandparents, they're my teachers, my second parents, and my best friends. Thank you for everything you've done for me upon y'all. Tell us what you plan to do, Shelby, after high school. We've got a special gift for them that I want to give them, and then we're going to be praying. We're going to pray over them as well. So, Audra, we thank you so much for being part of our group. Zach, we thank you. Obi, thank you. John. Madeline. Thank you. Shelby, here you go. Let me do this. Give them another round of applause. Before they march off, let's just pay them in prayer this morning. Father God, I just thank you so much for these 8 students, Lord, that are graduating this year. We've had others throughout the years as well that I wish were staying here with them. But Lord, I am so thankful that these 8 right here, I know as they leave, Lord, they have a foundation in you. God, they have a close connection to their family and friends. And these are all things that they're going to need to succeed. But God, I pray right now that you would just fill them with your spirit, God. That you would just guide them. Lord, I pray that you'd give them wisdom as they make just vital decisions in their life. And Lord, as they grow, I pray that they will also disciple those that are going to be coming up next, God. And just pouring into them like others have poured into their lives. So Lord, we thank you for them. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
front at this time. Let's all go to the Lord in prayer. God, I just thank you this morning that we can come into your house, Lord, that we can celebrate together, Lord, we can enjoy each other's company, fellowshipping with one another. Lord, that we can encourage our seniors as they graduate and move on to a new chapter in their life. And we just want to encourage them, let them know we're praying for them, and Lord, we're supporting them as they move on into this next chapter. God, I just thank you for the opportunity just to enjoy singing praises to you. Looking forward to the day that we get to fly away into eternity to be with you forever and ever. It's all because of who you are and that moment in our life when the light of your love, your grace, and your mercy shone into our lives and we saw the light for the first time. God, what a blessing it is to know that we're eternally secure through our salvation and only through the blood of Jesus Christ. God, I just pray that as we come before you this morning, Lord, that we would truly worship you. Lord, that we would truly surrender our lives to you. It's all because of who you are. It's all because you're alive, Lord, that you conquered death and the grave, that we have the opportunity to worship you and to live our lives for you. Lord, I pray that we do just that. Lord, take this offering. Do amazing things in us and through us as we seek to be all you've asked us to be, all you called us to be, as we serve you. Lord, all these things we need.
in your Bibles today, please turn to Acts chapter 18. I'm gonna veer off this morning off the passage that we're studying as we go through our life groups and going through the Bible as a church. In the New Testament. And so today I want us to look at Acts chapter 18 for just a moment, because I have a challenge, to our graduates. I have a challenge to not only our graduates, but to our other students and to our parents and our grandparents and to our church that I want us to look at this morning. And we will, mention that passage in Acts chapter 8, I believe it is, this morning. But I want to park in Acts chapter 18 this morning, starting with verses 18 through 23. And as we look at this, I want you to ask the question to yourself, what kind of trail are you leaving wherever you go? What kind of impact are you making? Graduates, as you look back, for the last 4 years of high school, have you made an impact on people's lives? Have you shared the gospel? Have you encouraged the other believers? Have you done something to strengthen them? Because as we look at this passage, that is exactly what Paul does. Everywhere he goes, he's making disciples. He's teaching, okay? And if you were to look at his life, and you can look back over the past year, or the past 2 years, you can tell where Paul was faithful and obedient to God's will. And so I want us to look again at Acts chapter 18. You can turn there in your Bibles. It will also be on the screen. Starting with verse 18, it says, "So Paul still remained a good while. Then he took leave of the brethren and sailed for Syria, and Priscilla and Aquila were there with him. He had his hair cut off at Cenchrea, for he had taken a vow. And he came to Ephesus, and he left them there, but he himself entered the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. When they had asked him to stay a longer time with them, he did not consent, but he took leave of them, saying, 'I must, by all means, keep this coming feast in Jerusalem, but I will return again to you, God willing.' And he sailed from Ephesus. And when he had landed in Caesarea and gone up and greeted the church, he went down to Antioch. After he had spent some time there, he departed and went over to the region of Galatia and Phrygia in order the strengthening of all disciples." And so I want us to look at a few things from this passage, because I do want us to look at the trail that Paul leaves. Now, I don't know how many hunters we have in here, how many deer hunters, but on top of that, how many people are actually bow hunters? Because I remember a few years back, probably more of you, haven't been able to do any hunting lately, especially with a bow, but I remember one of the hunts that I went on with a friend. And that day, as always, I got nothing. But as I got down after sitting in the tree stand for a couple hours, I got down and I started walking over to my friend where he was, just a little ways away from me. And as I saw him, he was climbing down and he was excited. And as I got closer, he said, "Hey, I got one." And I wanted to get one. He got two. And I said, "All right, this is awesome. I didn't get any. You got one for you and one for me." And then as we started to look, and as a hunter, and I don't want to sound gross here, but I think it does make us make a point. Whenever you kill an animal, there's usually going to be a trail somewhere, obviously. You're going to see where they're going because of possibly the blood. And as we got down, we immediately saw where one of the deer went off to. But then there was another one. He says, "I don't know if I really got it good." And we started to look for that, and the path just kind of, it was a little here, it was a little there. We really couldn't tell where this deer had gone. We couldn't see the trees or the grass maybe lying down, or some of the broken branches. We couldn't see the trail that deer had to find that one. And that just goes to show us, I think, a point. If we were to look at our lives, are we going to be like, one that, hey, we can clearly see where that person's been? Are we going to be like maybe others, where, yeah, they profess to be Christians, but you can't tell where they've been? You can't tell, hey, they've been mentoring this person. Hey, they've taught this class. hey, they've been serving here, you know, because all that they may do is just come in every now and then to a church service, every now and then to a Bible study, and they profess being a believer, but it is hard to tell by just where they've been. And so, Paul, there is a clear picture that everywhere he goes, it's obvious that he is obedient to God's will. And as we just look at the few chapters right here, even in this passage, you're going to see Paul going from one place to the next, fulfilling the great commission of sharing the gospel with all believers, with all people that he comes in contact with. In our passage, he goes from Corinth to Ephesus and then to Jerusalem and back to Antioch. All in just a short few verses, all of this is taking place. The end of his second journey and the beginning of his third journey. And again, all along the way, strengthening believers and sharing the gospel. So what kind of trail did Paul leave? Well, the first thing is this. As I notice these verses in verse 18, he left a trail of devotion. Let's read verse 18 again. So Paul still remained a good while. Then he took leave of the brother and sailed for Syria, and Priscilla and Aquila were with him. He had his hair cut off at Kentria, for he had taken a vow. Now, how do you come to that based off this passage right here? It is because he remained there not until he wanted to go, but until God said, hey, now it's time for you to go somewhere else. He wanted to make sure everything he was doing was within the will of God, going from place to place. And yeah, he could have said, hey, I've got a great job that these guys over here want me to go and do. But if God hasn't released him from one place, then why should he go to the next, even if it seems like a very good scenario? This just goes to show you how in tune Paul was with Christ, how in tune he was, how obedient he was to go wherever he was supposed to. And it just shows his devotion to God. It shows his devotion to the Word of God. It shows his devotion to the will of God. As I think about that word devotion, other words come to mind. I think about being loyal. I think about being dedicated. I think about being committed. All right? All synonyms for being devoted to someone. So hopefully this paints a clear picture about his devotion and what that really means. I got to thinking about this a couple days ago because I just recently officiated a wedding. And I remember as I looked through the vows, that when we were talking about a marriage, that all of these words were in the vows that one was promising to the next. Devotion, loyalty, dedication, committed. And that is a marriage that, you know, says, hey, I'm devoted no matter what. That's the statement. That was the purpose. That is what they're vowing before God and all people that are there at the wedding. They were saying, hey, look, there's no way out of this. I am devoted to my spouse. I am loyal to that person. I am dedicated to that person. I am committed to do whatever and stay in for the long haul. As I thought about this, it paints a picture of a marriage that there is a no way out clause. That is what commitment means. That is what devotion means. That no matter how rocky, no matter how crazy, that there is no way out. That I'm staying with this. And this is kind of the devotion that I see with Paul and the Word of God. There is no way out. If God said to go, he was going. If God said to stay, he's staying. If God said to go to the synagogue and reason with those people, he would do that. Because that's what God called him to be. The surrounding chapters, they talk about others that had the same characteristic. In chapter 7, we see the life of Stephen. We see how Stephen was a man that was full of faith and full of the Holy Spirit. Anytime you see the name Stephen there in Acts, that's what it's calling him. That's what it's saying. That he was full of faith, that he was full of the Holy Spirit, and he was so devoted, so committed to Jesus Christ that he gave his life for the gospel. Then we look at chapter 8. We look at Philip. We see how Philip was devoted because you know what? He said, hey, I don't care about racial barriers. I don't care about people group. I don't care about social class. I don't care what people are going to say. When God tells me to go and help somebody, help this eunuch to understand what he's reading, Philip went to soul. because he was devoted. In chapter 17, we also see a man named Jason who was beat. And it says that he's turned his world upside down. That's what it looks like to be committed. That's what it looks like to be devoted to Christ. Everywhere Paul went, he left that trail of devotion. So I ask our graduates here today, are you leading that kind of trail? When you go off to college, when you go off to the military, when you go off to the job force, okay? Are you that devoted to the gospel of Christ? Because I want to tell you something, if you're not, you are going to struggle. Because I promise you, there's going to be some agonizing peer pressure. But if you are devoted to the gospel, church, that goes for us. If we are devoted to Christ, then we are going to be successful, that God is going to keep leading us, that God is going to keep filling us, that God is still going to be the most important thing in our life. Here's something else Paul left. He left a trail of discipleship. In verse 19 it says, and he came to Ephesus and left them there, but he himself entered the synagogues and reasoned with the Jews. That word reason right there is talking about, hey, sharing the gospel, talking about not arguing, okay, but it's talking about defending the faith. It's talking about sharing the gospel. It's discipling somebody. And that is what Paul is doing in this passage. He is staying where God says to stay, and he is reasoning. He is making disciples. He does the same thing in Acts chapter 18, verse 4. It tells us that he's reasoning in the synagogue there. In Acts chapter 19, he is reasoning with the people. In Acts chapter 20, he's doing the same thing. We're going to see the fact that Paul is making disciples, and you can tell, it's very obvious. He is following the command of Matthew 28, 19 and 20. As Jesus leaves this earth, he gives one final command to go and make disciples. This is not a suggestion. This is for everybody. Graduates, I'm not just talking to you. I'm talking about everybody here. We should be training, and we should be teaching, and we should be pouring our lives into everybody, okay? In Sunday school, it's not just the teacher that can pour into the other people in that class. In our life groups, it's not just the facilitator. It's just not the life group leader. It's everybody can participate by finding somebody that they can pour their life in, whether it's somebody younger than them, whether it's somebody the same age as them, whether it's somebody that is possibly older than them. This is what we call spiritual multiplication. When we start pouring into others, and then all of a sudden you've got two people pouring into others, then you've got four people pouring into others. This is spiritual multiplication taking place. But what I see so often in the local church is that when somebody goes off to another church, when somebody, hey, maybe they go off to college, maybe they move off to a different location, they're leaving a hole because they're not pouring into others. And I think it's vital that we understand that, hey, we've got to leave a trail of discipleship. We've got to disciple others so that when we're gone, they can take our place. You see, here's my philosophy of ministry. Have a rock-solid relationship with Jesus Christ. A relationship of prayer, scripture, meditation, memorization, evangelism, and share what God reveals to me to other people. This is ministry. This is evangelism. This is discipleship. This is what it looks like. This is exactly what Jesus was doing here on this earth, okay? And the biggest reason that people do not make disciples, I believe the biggest reason is because maybe they don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And it's hard to share with somebody else what you do not have. So do you have a relationship with Christ this morning? Are you following His commands and making disciples? I want you to turn with me to Luke chapter 9. It's not going to be on the screen. I'm probably going to paraphrase most of this. But I chose one passage out of the New Testament Because I want you to see a picture of what Jesus Christ was doing. How he was leaving that trail of discipleship. How he took 12 men and he was pouring his life into those 12 men. I just want you to see just a kind of a day in the life of Jesus. Maybe it was a couple days. Maybe it was a week. But I want to show you what Jesus is doing. In Luke chapter 9. In verse 1. It says, then he called his 12 disciples together, and he gave them power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. And so what he is doing is he is sending his disciples out, giving them power, giving them authority to preach the gospel, to take it to every village, every tribe, no matter where they go. He's empowering them to go out to do this. And let me tell you, they are effective, okay? Because in this passage, it talks about Herod not liking what he's seeing. He's not liking, hey, there's people out there that are preaching something different than what I want told, okay? And so he doesn't like it. So I know that they're being effective. So Jesus sends them out. We know that they're effective. And then he calls them back and he disciples them some more. He pours some more into them. He prays over them some more, okay? And then he sends them back out to do this again, and he's continually doing this process. Here's a little more, and then here you go. Go out and do the same. Here's a little more, now go out and do the same. Studying the Word together, and then going out and making disciples. Then we get to verse 10, and we see that, hey, he was meeting privately. He got away from wherever he was, and he was meeting privately with his disciples. Probably teaching them some more. And then all of a sudden people see, hey, there's Jesus. Hey, there's the guy. Hey, he's been preaching. He's been touching people. He's been doing miracles. Hey, let's go. And so before you know it, there's a crowd of people. There's a multitude of people that now Jesus is feeding them, not just what we're going to see physically, but he's feeding them spiritually. For after they had met all day long. Now, here's where I have that problem, because we can barely make an hour, right? All right, when it's lunchtime, we're hungry. We want to go. Hey, we have a picnic to get to, right? These guys have been all day. Now they're getting hungry, and the disciples say, hey, we need to finish this up and come back and take up where we left off later, okay? Because everybody's getting hungry. And then Jesus says, oh, wait, I got this. He says, hey, you know, I've been teaching you guys that thing. You know, I've been teaching you guys to trust God, to provide for all of your needs. He says, watch this. And he takes just a little bit of food, right? He takes 5 loaves and 2 fishes, and he feeds a multitude until they couldn't eat more. And there was extras, there was leftovers. This is what Jesus is doing, is teaching his disciples. And then it says that they go off once again. And when they go off this next time, it's one of the most important passages, probably in this chapter right here, because it talks about Peter and his great confession. He has a conversation with the disciples, and I don't know if you remember how it goes. So I just want to kind of tell you about it just a little bit. I know you can read it right here, but I want you to really understand the meaning of this passage. You find it also in Matthew 16, I believe, as well. And we get a lot more information about this. But it says that, hey, Jesus went out praying. And then his disciples had walked up. And so he greets them. And he talks with them. Again, possibly teaching them some more. And as they're walking, they just so happen to be near Caesarea Philippi. And if you know anything about this city, all right, this city had many names in the past, all right? It was named after one of the false gods, okay? And now the name, Caesarea Philippi, is actually a name after one of the emperors, okay? And in this place, you're going to find a very ornate temple at the very top of a 100-foot rock wall. And some scholars would debate, hey, was he in the city? Was he near the city? Okay. And I'm going to say he had to be near the city because he was looking at that in the distance. He was looking at this huge rock and a very ornate temple where, hey, false gods have been worshipped. Where there's altars that were up in the name of these false gods. And you know what? He was about to teach them a very important lesson about a rock. And as he teaches Peter, Peter as he says, "Hey, who do people say that I am?" As he's got this in view, who do people say that I am? The disciples said, "Hey, some think you're John the Baptist, some think you're Elijah, some think you're just a great prophet." And Jesus says, "Who do you say that I am, though?" And Peter said this, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And I believe what Jesus was asking him and what Peter was referring back to, he says, "Jesus, you're not some emperor. You're not just some false god. You're not just some false worship. You are the Son of the living God." As we look at this in the distance, as we see what people are worshiping in this world, God, you are way above that. Your teachings are way above that because you are Christ, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus says, "Well, upon this rock," and he's not talking about this 100-foot wall. He's not talking about what's at the top of that 100-foot wall. What he's telling Peter is, "Peter, upon this rock, upon your faith, upon what you're acknowledging here, I will build my church." And he's making disciples. This is what Jesus is showing us. And then right after this, he says, "You know what? I'm going to suffer. I'm going to be killed. And I'm going to rise again." And he says, "If you want to follow me, you've got to take up your cross daily and follow me. You've got to be obedient, even if it means death." You see, all this is in this one chapter. All of this, what Jesus is doing, how he's making disciples, it's all in one place. And I believe it helps us understand the fact that we too have to be making disciples, leaving a trail of discipleship. But then I want you to notice one last thing. He left a trail of determination. In verses 20 through 21, it says, "When they asked him to stay longer time with them, he did not consent. But he took leave of them, saying, 'I must by all means keep this coming feast in Jerusalem, but I will return again to you, God willing.' And he sailed from Ephesus." So what we see, Paul, once again, determined to obey God, determined to do the will of God. And he was so in tune with God. He says, "Wait, God don't want me to go here. He wants me to go here." This is the kind of determination that he had, determined to be obedient to God. I want to tell you something. Sometimes it's hard to be obedient. It's hard to follow everything that Jesus tells us. It's hard sometimes, but we've got to be determined to be obedient to God. You know, as I was thinking about, hey, is there a word picture of this possibly? Is there something that we may have seen about determination? And here's the closest thing that I can come up with. As many of y'all know, just a month ago, John and Travis, they had a fire that happened right beside their apartment. And you know what? As I thought about that determination, about how they said, "Hey, somebody was practically beating our door down to tell us there's a fire here. You need to get out." I'm thinking, man, if we would be that determined to share the gospel, we're that determined to be obedient because we've got family members all around us that need to hear the gospel. We've got friends all around us that need to hear the gospel, because if they don't hear the gospel and respond to it, if they don't accept Jesus Christ as their Savior, there's going to be an eternal separation from God. There's going to be an eternal hell, a real place, a real hell, that they will be separated from God for eternity. And we need to be that determined to make sure that our friends and our family members know what Jesus is doing, know how to be obedient to Him. And so I wonder if we're leaving a trail of determination. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 30, it says this, "He who is not with me, and he who does not gather with me, scatters abroad." As I see this, there's two types of people. There's people that are going to gather people to God's kingdom. There's people that are going to scatter. And we need to make sure that we're not scattering people. We need to make sure that, hey, that we are living a life, that is clearly of God. We need to live a life that's clear and compelling and Christ-like. And so my challenge to our graduates, is this how you're living your life? The last 4 years, you say, "Hey, I've left a trail of determination. I've left a trail of discipleship. I've left a trail of devotion. Church, can we move back over to past year and say the same thing? In early African converts to Christianity, they were so devoted to having their quiet time. They wanted that private time. And so it was reported that they would go out and they would find a place in the jungle so that they could be by themselves. And they were so determined, so devoted to having that time every single day that it began to wear a trail where their spot was. And the cool thing about that is when other people saw, hey, I can tell you're not going every day because there's grass growing all over your trail. Hey, is there something that I can help you with? Can I help you get back on track here? They didn't want the grass to grow over the trail. And I wonder if that's the same thing that might be happening in some of our lives. For some, we can be that devoted to God that our trail is firm, it's solid, it can be seen, not just for the sake of being seen. Because there's a passage in the Bible that we can talk about that. Or is the grass growing over your trail? I want you to bow your heads with me just for a moment. I wonder, how is your trail this morning that you're leading? You see, as we begin this time of reflection, and we have this time of invitation, I can't help but think that my desire and the desire of our church is for God to ignite us, for God to use us, for God to say, hey, revival is going to take place and it's going to start with this individual or this group or this church. Are you determined enough to want this revival to take place right here, starting with you? Are you devoted to the cause of Christ? Are you pouring into others, making disciples? Is there one person maybe that God has put on your mind that you, hey, I want to pour into this person. I know that God is drawing me this way. Maybe you're already pouring your life into that person. Have you prayed for him today? Have you prayed for him this week? And so I challenge you to pray and ask God, hey, who can I pour into? So that I can help them understand the gospel. So that they can go out and tell somebody else. Graduates, again, it's not going to be easy as you leave home. So I wonder, parents, grandparents, church, I challenge you to pray for one of these students. To pray for them every single day because they're going to get started and it's going to be an eye-opener for them. I just want to challenge you to take one of them and pray. Heavenly Father, God, as we come to this point in this service, God, I pray that you just speak to us, have your way. Help us to be obedient to what you're calling us to do. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me? Would you sing this invitation?